The concept of a Black History Month in February stemmed from the earlier creation of an entire week dedicated to the achievements and struggles of Black Americans. Although this goes beyond just 28 or 29 days, every year, the shortest month of all has produced numerous stories of Blacks breaking the color barrier in an effort to obtain equality for all. Shout out to BET for the facts on this day in Black History Month. On February 1st, 1960, four college students staged a peaceful sit-in at a whites-only lunch counter at a Woolworths in Greensboro, North Carolina, to protest segregation. Over time, hundreds of Black collegians joined the protest, which sparked other sit-ins in similar Southern venues. Eventually, Woolworths desegregated all their stores in July of 1960. On February 2, 2009, President Barack Obama confirmed Eric Holder as the United States Attorney General, making him the first African-American to hold such a position. The Columbia University graduate is an accomplished lawyer who once prosecuted a corrupt politician and represented the National Football League. He also served as Deputy Attorney General under the Clinton administration. On February 3, 1956, the University of Alabama admitted their first Black student, Authorene Lucy. Unfortunately, due to backlash from angry segregationists, the school suspended her over, quote, safety concerns. Authorene filed a lawsuit against the college, which eventually landed in the Supreme Court, who ruled in her favor. Although the school initially expelled her for slander, in 1980, they reversed their decision and welcomed her back to campus. Authorene would earn her master's at the university in the 90s, and the school would later honor her with a scholarship and portrait. On February 4, 1913, civil rights activist Rosa Parks was born in Tuskegee, Alabama. By refusing to give up her seat on a Montgomery bus in 1955, she sparked a year-long bus boycott and essentially the African-American civil rights movement. Rosa received numerous awards during her lifetime, including an astounding 40-plus honorary doctorates and the Presidential Medal of Freedom in 1996. On February 5, 1958, the White House confirmed Clifton Wharton Sr. as an ambassador to Romania, making him the first African-American diplomat to serve Europe. Clifton was a lawyer in Boston in the mid-1920s and became the first Black foreign diplomat in 1925. In 2006, the U.S. Postal Service honored him with a postage stamp. On February 6, 1820, almost 90 free Blacks sailed aboard the Mayflower of Liberia to the British colony of Sierra Leone in West Africa. The Quakers funded this trip, believing that racism in America was impossible to eradicate, and Africa was a more favorable place for Blacks to live. Unfortunately, shortly after they landed in Sierra Leone, many passengers died from malaria. However, over the following four decades, up to 20,000 Blacks would sail to a neighboring African region and form the country of Liberia. As I mentioned earlier, on February 7, 1926, philosopher Carter G. Woodson founded Negro History Week during the second week of February, which he chose because Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln's birthdays fell on that week. 50 years later, the week was expanded to what we now call Black History Month. Carter emphasized the importance of independence among African Americans, and we consider him the father of Black history. On February 8, 1986, Oprah Winfrey debuted her nationally syndicated talk show, a first for a Black woman. Not only did the Oprah Winfrey Show last for 25 years, but Oprah's broadened her horizons by launching a magazine, a radio show, and a television network. And to stress the importance of education, she opened a school for girls in South Africa. She's pretty much done it all. On February 9, 1995, Bernard Harris spent over 8 days in outer space on his second spaceflight, making him the first Black astronaut to take a spacewalk. While in space, he made 129 orbits and logged almost 3 million miles. Wow. On February 10, 1990, Grammy-winning producer and musician Quincy Jones hosted and served as the musical guest of an unforgettable episode of the 15th season of Saturday Night Live. He replaced the traditional monologue with a song called Manteca, which celebrated Nelson Mandela's release from prison. Quincy also performed a jazz medley with his band and collaborated with at least 10 artists from the 1990s. And speaking of Nelson Mandela, on February 11, 1990, officials at Robben Island, a tough prison in South Africa, finally released the anti-apartheid activist after he served a sentence that people considered unfair. He initially received 5 years in prison for, quote, leaving the country without a passport, but later received a life sentence for sabotage in 1964. After Nelson served 27 years in prison, the country granted global pleas for his release. On February 12, 1909, over 60 descendants of abolitionists and black activists founded the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, or the NAACP, in New York. Initially, the founding members, which included W.E.B. Du Bois and Ida B. Wells, started the organization in response to a race riot in Springfield, Illinois, the previous year. Their goal was to stop racism and achieve, quote, political, educational, social, and economic equality. On February 13, 1983, renowned singer Marvin Gaye performed a memorable rendition of the national anthem at that year's NBA All-Star Game. His soulful voice and use of a drum machine contributed to a, quote, black twist on the Star-Spangled Banner. Marvin received a standing ovation, and the late Los Angeles Lakers owner Jerry Buss called his performance, quote, one of the greatest of all time. On February 14, 1957, several civil rights leaders founded the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, or the SCLC, at a meeting in New Orleans, and appointed Martin Luther King Jr. president. Similar to the NAACP, this organization worked towards, quote, social, economic, and political justice through several campaigns. For instance, their crusade for citizenship urged thousands of disenfranchised African Americans to register to vote, and Operation Breadbasket implored blacks not to support racist businesses. And during their Poor People's Campaign, 3,000 people rallied for employment and housing in Washington, D.C., following the assassination of Martin Luther King. Both the NAACP and the SCLC still exist today. On February 15, 1968, symphony conductor Henry Lewis transformed the New Jersey Symphony into a major orchestra, becoming a rare African-American conductor of such a group. A multi-instrumentalist since childhood, Henry conducted the 7th Army Symphony and assisted in conducting the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra from 1961 to 1968, the year he joined the New Jersey Symphony. According to the New York Times, he took this orchestra to Carnegie Hall, the Kennedy Center, and the Metropolitan Opera in New York, becoming the first African-American to conduct at the latter venue. On February 16, 1874, the Freedmen's Bureau elected abolitionist Frederick Douglass president. The Bureau included a bank established by Abraham Lincoln a decade earlier, with the goal of encouraging African Americans to save their money. Among other blacks, soldiers invested almost $3 million into the bank from 1865 to 1871, but lost their money due to, quote, overexpansion, mismanagement, and fraud. Just months after joining the bank, Frederick asked Congress to close it. On February 17, 1942, civil rights activist Huey P. Newton was born in Monroe, Louisiana. In the 1960s, he co-founded the Black Panther Party, a paramilitary organization that created programs for underserved blacks. Huey played a key role in the Black Power movement of that decade. On February 18, 1867, Baptist minister Reverend William Jefferson White founded the Augusta Theological Institute in Augusta, Georgia. The institute aimed to educate young African-American men religious studies. Eventually, the college moved to Atlanta, and in 1885, it was renamed Morehouse College. Morehouse's first black president expanded majors to secular fields, and the school eventually became the, quote, first historically black college to produce a Rhodes Scholar. On February 19, 1942, in the middle of World War II, the Tuskegee Airmen, also known as the Red Tails, due to the red tails and propellers on their aircraft, became the first black pilots to join the Army. Despite enduring prejudice abroad, by the end of the war, they accomplished a lot. Almost 1,000 fighters, quote, carried out more than 200 bomber escort missions, damaged over 400 German planes and 950 ground units, and sank a battleship. On February 20, 1992, 24-year-old film director John Singleton became the first African-American to receive an Oscar nomination for Best Director, as well as the youngest such nominee. After the South Los Angeles native graduated from USC Film School, he spearheaded the critically acclaimed urban drama Boys in the Hood, for which he received this esteemed honor. He also worked on several other celebrated films over the following two decades, including Poetic Justice, Higher Learning, and Hustle and Flow. On February 21st, 1965, a gunman assassinated human rights activist Malcolm X in Harlem, New York. After surviving a rough upbringing, Malcolm spent 6 years in prison, where he discovered the Nation of Islam. He initially called for the, quote, self-defense and liberation of African Americans, implying violent action, which clashed with MLK's belief in nonviolent civil disobedience. However, he departed from the Nation of Islam due to a conflict of beliefs and founded his own group, the Organization of Afro-American Unity. This marked a shift in his beliefs from self-defense to nonviolence, similar to those of MLK, and he was addressing his new group at a meeting when he was murdered. On February 22, 1988, DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince, aka Will Smith, won a Grammy Award for a brand new category, Best Rap Performance, for their song Parents Just Don't Understand. The other artists nominated in this category were LL Cool J, Salt-N-Pepa, Kool Moe Dee, and JJ Fad. On February 23, 1929, baseball player Elston Howard was born in St. Louis. Before playing and coaching Major League Baseball, he started his professional career in the American Negro League. Elston broke color barriers in baseball by becoming the first black player in the New York Yankees, and in 1963, the first black most valuable player, or MVP, of the American League. Additionally, he won 6 World Series and 2 Gold Glove Awards, and from 1967 to 1973, he held the fielding percentage record. On February 24, 1864, Rebecca Lee Crumpler earned a doctorate from the New England Female Medical College in Massachusetts, becoming the first black female medical doctor. She later published her Book of Medical Discourses, and in 1865, she cared for freed slaves in Richmond, Virginia, after the Civil War. On February 25, 1870, Mississippi voters elected Hiram Revels to the Senate, making him the first African-American in the legislative house. Sadly, some of his fellow senators questioned his citizenship, despite his birth to free black parents. He denounced a law that would simultaneously readmit Georgia to the Union and prevent blacks in that state from holding office. He only served in Congress for a year, and after a short tenure, he became the president of a college in his home state of Mississippi. On February 26, 2012, a so-called neighborhood watchman murdered 17-year-old Trayvon Martin in Sanford, Florida, because the teen apparently, quote, looks suspicious, a clear-cut case of racial profiling. Unsurprisingly, a jury acquitted the gunman due to state stand-your-ground laws, a verdict criticized by most people, including then-President Obama. And while the killer still trolls people, Trayvon's parents set up a foundation in his name to advocate for the families of victims of violent crime. On February 27, 1872, Charlotte E. Ray graduated from Howard University Law School, becoming the first black female lawyer. She also practiced law before the Federal Court of the District of Columbia, not the Supreme Court we recognize. on February 28, 1964, jazz legend Thelonious Monk graced the cover of Time magazine. Believe it or not, as an adolescent, the Apollo Theater banned him because he won too many talent contests. He did not achieve major success until his 40s when he collaborated with another jazz legend, John Coltrane. Time magazine music critic Barry Farrell wrote an article about Thelonious, hence his magazine cover, and discussed how the musician wrote 57 unique compositions about his life in New York. In 1986, 4 years after his death, Thelonious' family founded a jazz institute named after him. Now, given this last accomplishment occurred on Leap Year Day, it was hard to find. But on February 29, 1940, actress Hattie McDaniel won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role as Mammy in Gone with the Wind, making her the first Black Oscar winner. Although she paved the way for other Black actresses to win this category, it is hard to ignore the fact that she played a stereotypical Mammy. Blacks have broken barriers in all walks of life, including arts and entertainment, sports, politics, education, science, the military, law, finance, and human rights. But it's demonstrated by the daily injustices Black people face, such as discrimination, police brutality, and senseless murder, we still have a long way to go in terms of achieving equality for all. That's why we shouldn't just celebrate Black History in February, but every single day.